good evening. I really appreciate you inviting me this evening. It's a real pleasure. So I've been invited to speak about the history of Christmas, and I'm just going to shorten it up a lot and talk about Christmas in America. I think that that is the American Christmas is different from other Christmases, and it's not merely a compilation of European things. It's something that's wholly, uniquely grown in the United States. So, let me tell you a little bit about, this is kind of, for me, it's interesting because I get to talk about Christmas. Lots of times people talk about Christmas to me. And there are a couple of things that have become sort of standards, just as a category. And one is that people talk about, they tell me about the Christmases that they have, which I find really interesting. I learn an awful lot by people telling me what they do in their families and what their families used to do. The second is a set of categories that are kind of vague, but one of them is, I'm virtually blind, so I'm just going to kind of, can you still hear me? Can you still hear me? Because there's more light over here. Okay. So, the other one is people say Christmas arrives earlier and earlier each year. Everyone goes, yes. I actually found a website where someone's got a cell phone, has taken cell phone pictures, and they're dating them to see how early they can find the first. Right now, it's somewhere October 6th or something. Last year, somebody had their photo of some Christmas display. The second thing that people talk about often is that Christmas has become too commercial. And this is a theme that's run through Christmas from, oh, I can't even tell you how long ago. I can get you at least back to Charlie Brown's Christmas, where Lucy just, she says, this Christmas thing is just a big commercial racket. And then then they work it out. And then we can go back farther and farther, and I can get you to at least 1800 and people saying Christmas is too commercial. But the point is it summed up all of these comments in these categories, these last two categories, are that Christmas is just not the same as it used to be. And as a historian, this seems to me to beg for going back in time someplace. I think that my statement that I would begin with then is that Christmas has always been a challenge to a culture. It expresses a culture, but it's always been a challenge to cultural norms and challenge to our ideals. So, and because it challenges constantly, it's never the same as it used to be. It changes the same way that culture always changes, sometimes in response to it, sometimes it reinforces it, but it's always changing. So to begin, and this will be some really quick hops that I'm going to do, is that Christmas, as I'm certain you know, but I'm compelled to tell you, was probably first celebrated sometime in the 4th century, early 4th century, as a feast of the Nativity. And the Catholic Church established that, the Roman Catholic Church. And the problem was that the Romans were going absolutely wild, and especially on the 25th of December. I mean, they were pagan. And so the idea was, the Catholic Church is concerned that they're becoming increasingly monotheistic. And so they decided to hold a Feast of the Nativity, and it would be on December 25th. The idea being that this wouldn't keep people from celebrating in the streets in all of the possible pagan ways they could think of, but there would also be a church to go to. So right from the very beginning, there's this tension between sacred and secular that I think probably is pretty key to understanding what Christmas is, how it's evolved. Okay, so let me really fast forward and talk about a little bit about this holiday as it evolves early on in America's history. Christmas is celebrated in their colonies in many, many different ways, and still those same tensions between holy and wild behavior. Some celebrations were more holy or more reverent, and some were decidedly more wild. But most infamously, probably, is, see, I'm going to skip. This is the problem. I make these PowerPoints. What I wanted to show you is this is just Christmas shopping and people, this whole idea of Christmas, having these ideas that what we see as lots of Christmas behavior, this is back in the 40s, 1940s, but I just like the idea of the crowd, of people celebrating. This is where I wanted to get us to, though, and that is that most infamously, probably, is when Massachusetts Bay Puritans decided to outright ban Christmas. This was actually, in some ways, one-upping all of the Puritans that were already in England. In England, in 1647, the Puritans had taken control of Parliament, and they decided that they just about had it with what went on at Christmas. The idea of the Puritans being that they wanted to purify the Church of England. And by this time, the Church of England had all of the celebrations that the Roman Catholic Church did. So there's all sorts of revelry that goes on at Christmas. There are masks, gambling, plays, any sort of behavior that you could think of that is decidedly Saturday night behavior was Christmas behavior, and it would last for at least the 12 days. So when the Puritans come into power, well, then they decide that they needed to really put a stop to it. They could not find, I can't find, so that solves it. There's no proof of, there's no discussion of the birth of Christ in the Bible. And from the Puritan standpoint, if it wasn't in the Bible, then we're not going to celebrate it. What the Puritans looked at Christmas is they looked at it, and all of these things to them added up to the Pope did it. And that it's a very anti-Roman Catholic statement that's being said here. I like all the idea of similar satanical practices, so you can kind of get a whole idea of what the Puritans are thinking. So, this lasted up until 1681, when William and Mary came to power, and they looked across to the colonies, had really decided that the one place that they found the most troublemakers ever was in Massachusetts Bay Colony. Those are the people who were the most critical, the most independent-minded, the prickliest. Yes, that's, we believe it true. And so William and Mary just decided they would start putting some controls on the colonies, and having them get rid of this particular law was just one example of England trying to get control back over the colonies that it had. My thought is it didn't turn out so well, because the colonies ultimately, you know, they rebelled. So it didn't work. Then I think that I'm going to fast forward again, because the thing about Christmas is that this is an extreme, but there are celebrations all throughout the colony. Some last a day, some are 3 days. I think the Moravians sometimes had 2 days. There are places throughout the South that will go on for 2 weeks, 3 weeks, because that's finally the crops are in and people can gather together, and it's so much travel that they would you know, stay together for a week, 2 weeks, whatever it took, give slaves the you know, time off during the season. So it changes according to geography, according to the many Protestant sects, the Roman Catholics, and also a lot of people who just simply didn't go to church and obviously didn't celebrate any Christmas. So there's both church and non-church, and there's wild and there's holy. Finally, at the beginning of the 19th century, these colonial days far past, we start to get a clearer idea of this Christmas that I would call an American Christmas. In other words, all these various disparate kinds of Christmases start to kind of come together to form a single idea of what Christmas is. This happens at the same time at the beginning of the 19th century. There are a number of people who are very concerned about what the nation's going to turn out to be like, wanting to control. Like Noah Webster was concerned because people were using all sorts of words in all sorts of ways. And so one of the things he wanted to do is publish a dictionary and would standardize speech. Just an example of the way we start to establish national holidays. Famously, I guess, would be Washington's birthday, the 4th of July, but the United States had virtually nothing on its calendar. And people talked about this all the time. Americans worked all the time. There was no time off. And whether it was for patriotic days or religious days, I think in Europe at the time, it was common to have about one-third of the days were feast, days off, local holidays. In European society, and Americans were just absolutely always working. So there are a variety of reasons where people were kind of thinking about we needed a national calendar as well. So cities are starting to grow. There's a new middle class that's starting to get larger. There's a great deal of democracy that's breaking out all over, and that's alarming to a lot of people. One of the people alarmed with democracy, which means that the guys beneath us are acting like they're our equals, was Washington Irving. So if you read Knickerbocker Tales, you hear he creates a history of New York City. And part of this is to kind of reinstill this kind of an idea of an old order. And just as an incidental character in a history of New York, there is a character who arrives and lays his finger aside of his nose and goes on and talks. So he's got there are a couple of people in there that sound a little bit like St. Nicholas, and then there's another one that has another characteristic that might sound sort of Santa Claus-y, and so we're you start to kind of get hints and pieces of people looking for some characters also who can stand at the center of these, sort of this new national order. So if a Christmas is going to start showing up, we need to know, what's it going to look like and what's going to happen to it. I would say that one of the things about Americans is that they have a real penchant, or at least historians have remarked on this, a real penchant for borrowing things, improving things, adapting things, renewing things, inventing. And all of this comes to the fore throughout the culture, but we can see it in Christmas. We were talking, Mr. Keener and I were talking earlier this evening about the whole idea of Christmas being one of those things that is almost a barometer of a culture. So what you see going on in Christmas, you can kind of track in other places in the culture, maybe more intensely, but you get flavors of it in Christmas. And in this case, we see that the nation is inventing something that is uniquely American, that is not religious, and it's not sacred, and it's not secular. It's kind of its own thing. So where this starts, I think, and I feel kind of bad saying this because there are just a couple of guys that invented Christmas. It's and they were in New York City, which makes it even sort of more difficult, So, but here's the story. Okay, so there's a group of men in New York City, early 19th century, and they're concerned because New York City is not the premier city. That's not necessarily the port you'd want to go to. You might want to go to Charleston, you might want to go to Philadelphia, but it's not the big trading center. So there are a group of businessmen that are interested in boosting. They're city boosters. They want to create a city atmosphere that is attractive. So they found this organization called the St. Nicholas Society. St. Nicholas Society, St. Nicholas's death day is December 6th. And so the society decided they would start having their meetings on December 6th. And one of the members was Washington Irving. There's another man whose name is John Pintard. And then there's a third one whose name is Clement Clark Moore. So these men are all in association with one another, and they commission this. This is a woodcut, and this is one of the earliest images. Nobody has found any evidence of St. Nicholas being in the United States or, in the colonies at all. This is the first time, apparently, that he appears in the United States. So here's St. Nicholas, and you can see that he's got, I have a laser pointer. And I left the cats at home. So here's this, can you see this little dot? Okay. So here is a bishop. This is the Bishop of Myra from Turkey. And the bishop is, he's got all this sort of robe thing going on that's very Roman Catholic. Here is a good child and a bad child. I'd like to point out the good child is a girl, bad child's a boy. Bad child gets sticks or switches, good child gets toys. And they're all gathered around the hearth. This bishop actually did live, got sainthood with the Roman Catholic Church, and then sort of, the track is not really clear, but kind of disappeared into Europe as a folk hero. So he ceased to be so central as a Catholic saint, and as a folk character, gets far north into Europe. So he's fairly well known to especially people in Amsterdam. The Bishop of Myra did a number of things. At least this is what he got sainthood for. There were some girls whose father was going to sell them into whatever you sell girls into, because he was absolutely broke. And one of the things that St. Nicholas, who if you look up St. Nicholas on Google, he's a patron saint of everything. But in this case, apparently he threw three bags of gold into the house and took the girls out so they'd be safe. But those three bags of gold are the ones that hang over a pawnbroker's. I don't know if they still have them, but you see some places that they've at least painted three round balls over a pawnbroker's store. Anyway, this bishop wanders into Amsterdam, and now I'm back into New York City, and I've got these people at the St. Nicholas Society, and they're saying, we need really something for our town. We need to have a patron saint of New York City. Let's have that patron saint be Saint Nicholas. And there's these tales about this Saint Nicholas who arrives in a ship from Spain, and he brings oranges. He explains the oranges in the toes of the stockings. Do you guys get oranges? Probably Santa doesn't visit you, right? Okay, do your children, do they get oranges in the toes of the stockings? They should. I'm just checking. No? I always did, and I was offended, always. It was just big and orange and took up too much space. They decide they're going to have a patron saint. So St. Nicholas becomes the patron saint. I just found out exactly the date. In 1859, there was a bank called Howard Bank in New York City, and banks would issue their own money, their own banknotes, and these banknotes had Santa Claus on them. New York City kind of stayed with that. I'd like Santa Claus money. This woodcut, then, is what we're really looking at, is the very beginning of this idea of St. Nicholas. One of these members, as I told you, who belonged to the St. Nicholas Society, but he was far up. I mean, he was, there's a lot of class divisions. And while Washington Irving and John Pintard were of a certain high economic class, moving way up was Clement Clark Moore. Clement Clark Moore owned this little estate in New York City, and he called it Chelsea. Yeah, get that idea in your mind. It's like this huge place, and he's feeling closed in because the city's growing so fast. And one of the things, and so he's an Episcopal priest, he's extremely wealthy, and he's been bothered recently by these young men. There are lots of young immigrant men that just come to the United States, you know, they're single and they're young. And they apparently have some class animosities, and they are going into rich neighborhoods, and they're pulling down fences and breaking windows and going through hedges and just kind of basically wrecking havoc, petty thievery. And it had become a real problem for many people in, I guess, what would be lower Manhattan, which is where most of the population was. And Clement Clark Moore is feeling especially kind of challenged by this. So that seems to be kind of beside the point until you think about this poem that he wrote. And the poem that he wrote, which you know, is called A Visit from St. Nicholas. This is one of the first illustrations for this by F.O.C. Darley. And I like these pictures of Santa Claus because you can kind of see what happens. I was also interested when I was putting together this talk how much of the Christmas, you can trace Christmas just through what Santa Claus is doing and looking like. Here he is, he's, I would say the things that I'd point out mostly is we see the little old driver so lively and quick. He's just a little guy. And he's really, he's not quite human. I mean, he's pretty much there, but he's not quite human. He's got furs on. There's this holy and wild tension is interesting when you look at these pictures of Santa Claus, because the red clothing are very papal, Roman, suggestive of a bishop, but from Northern Europe, there are characters who are fur covered, and they're very wild and very close to nature. And so you see Santa Claus in various ways, kind of sometimes more wild, sometimes more sacred. So Clement Clark Moore sitting with his children, and he says, "Well, even though I'm an Episcopal and I don't believe in any of this sort of thing, I'm going to write this poem called A Visit from St. Nicholas. 'Twas the night before Christmas when all through the house, shall we recite it together?" You can do it now, you'll do it for the rest of the evening. So he creates this for his own children. It was just private. And then apparently, possibly one of the people that, you know, visiting cousin, took the poem, and it was republished in another newspaper. Then newspapers notoriously stole from each other. And so each year, well, there were more and more publications of A Visit from St. Nicholas. In A Visit from St. Nicholas, you get almost a template for how to celebrate Christmas. You have this character, you don't have a religious severity to it. You've got a right jolly old elf. And this right jolly old elf sneaks in. So remember those wild immigrant boys that are always at, you know, sort of annoying the Moore household and others? This is a Stephen Nissenbaum argument that the Santa Claus that's created, the Saint Nick that's created by Clement Clark Moore is actually a worker. And he does all the reverse things of those wild immigrant boys. He sneaks into the house, and instead of stealing, he drops things down, you know, he leaves things for the children. He is good-humored. He is unobtrusive. He doesn't break anything. I mean, he's sort of the perfect intruder, as immigrants are intruders. So I think that this is kind of a theme that runs as a really thin undercurrent in, having troubles here, a thin undercurrent in the way that we talk about American Christmas is that there are so many new people coming into the nation. How do you think about them, talk about them, incorporate them? And this is what Clement Clark Moore did, is he completely tamed the worker. One of the things that was pointed out by archaeologists who've done lots of digging in New York City and said the Dutch workers had short-stemmed pipes. And if you remember in A Visit from St. Nicholas, it's a little short pipe that he held tight in his teeth. The workers apparently, because these long pipes, they would break them so that they only had a short pipe and they wouldn't, you know, get involved in, you know, the pipe wouldn't get in the way of the work. And so this little old driver, so lively and quick, has got a little short pipe. When you see St. Nicholas later on in the century, he's back to the upper classes. The upper classes have the long pipes. So in the visit from St. Nicholas, then, I'd say that we've got almost all the conditions for at least imagining. We don't have a visual picture, but we've got a visual imagination. For we've got stockings, we've got home, we've got gifts, we've got children, snow, there's a mysterious stranger, there are 8 tiny reindeer, and my favorite, there's sugar. Or sugar plums, I guess, but same thing. I like this next picture. It was done in 1897. I think this was part of a stereopticon picture, but this particular place set up these tableaux, which was very common in the late 19th century. I find this Santa just as creepy as one that I'm going to show you later on, but. The caption down here, I don't know if you can see, is, oh ho, another stocking to fill. And so there's a baby there. And so you can see this Santa Claus has got, that's an animal skin that he's wearing. I'm not certain what animal, but it looks like a pinto bear or something. But it's furry. And this great big old Father Christmas sort of look to it. I just noticed the dead fox on the floor, too, and that bothers me a little bit, but I think it's fitting with the culture. What? I can't hear you. Oh, well, it took me a while, but see, look at him. See, there's little foxy eyes and his little pointy ears. And he looks like he's been... You know, it's a pelt. But when I look at that, and then I look at this up here, I don't think they're any of my ancestors. That's all I can say. So there are other things. We are this is 1823 that Moore writes the poem, gets reprinted. I can see in diaries where people are trying this out. They're trying to hanging stockings. And this is like throughout you read the poem and you say, oh, let's try that at home. One of the things that's happening is that home is becoming more important. And the families are getting smaller. If a woman is lucky enough, she will be able to stay at home and practice being the true and perfect woman. And so this Christmas is starting to really center around home. We don't see much church in this at all. It is a home festival. We need some more things, though, to make it Christmas. So let's not go that far. So another thing that happens is I start seeing somewhere in the 1840s, people mentioning Christmas trees, but they're in the upper classes and they are in the large cities. This, though, I think that is particularly important because this was published in Godey's Ladies Magazine, which meant, and every woman read Godey's Ladies Magazine. If she didn't subscribe, someone loaned it to her and then she'd loan a copy to somebody. And this is actually, was an English picture. But when Godey's published it, they took the crown off and they took all the indicators of royalty. And so this becomes an American family. So this is the first time you can start to see, oh, this is what we can do at Christmas beside the stockings. And then I start seeing in diaries that women men are cutting down the trees, dragging them in, and women are setting these up in the living room. notice the short tree and the big distance between the branches so that when you light the candles, it doesn't go up in huge flame. But this is the whole family gathered around a tree. None of these 6-foot trees, but a tabletop tree. The Civil War seems to be, for all sorts of ways, I mean, beyond the Civil War itself, such a watershed in American history that we have bits and parts of a Christmas started, but it's just really for basically wealthy people, and it's basically northeastern cities, although I can start to see lots of evidence of like Christmas trees. Some man made a handmade Christmas tree out of barrel staves out in the middle of the plains. For some reason he wrote, today I made a Christmas tree out of barrel staves. But, or people getting mulberry bushes because they couldn't find any pine trees, but they're improvising. But I want to turn to the late 19th century, I think, is where we really start to see the development of what we regard the old-fashioned Christmas. The urban middle class grows. Women are still homemakers. Their factories are producing goods like crazy. There are department stores for the first time. Department stores haven't been around all that long. And half of the population, okay, think about this, half of the population of America is immigrant. So this is what the nation is starting to try to deal with. There's a tremendous amount of technological change. There's a lot of new population. The Civil War solved the problem of the divided nation. Now, definitely the North is making the rules. And there is a sentiment that runs through the culture at large about, weren't there better days or calmer days? And that sort of nostalgia for home, and something gets created that becomes that old-fashioned Christmas. So the old-fashioned Christmas is almost itself an expression of nostalgia. I think one of the major people in this that creates this is Thomas Nast. You've seen Thomas Nast's work everywhere. He created the donkey for the Democratic Party, elephant for the Republican Party, and here you see the first beginnings of him working on creating Santa Claus. Nast was an ardent Republican. He just, so he was a real union man. And so here's his Santa Claus, and here he is in his fur. It looks like stars, but it's fur, and there are the stripes. And he's delivering, well, that's a one of those jumping jack toys to Union troops. And here are some young boys here. So this doesn't say a whole lot, except that we've got Santa Claus all in service of the U.S., that this has become something that Thomas Nast is interested in. Thomas Nast, it turns out, when he has his own children, is a Christmas nut. He looks like Santa Claus and apparently would just like go completely wild in decorating the house and everything on the mantelpiece, everything reenacted, the stockings, the surprises, everything. The man loved Christmas. But here he's just beginning. That was in December of 1862. This is 1 year later. This is called Furlough. And you can see that here's a man who's got incredible talent. He's a German immigrant. He cuts these wood blocks in, as etchings. And these are all hand, you take the end of a piece of wood where the grain is all, it's really difficult to carve. And all of this is an etching that's printed in Harper's Magazine, which is widely published. But look at the parts that he's got. So he's got, there's the family being reunited. There's the short Christmas tree. Here's Santa Claus at, looking over the children, his pack. Over here, the children are at the fireplace hanging up their stockings. And then here's the family all together. And here's the nativity. So he's got the whole tableau set up kind of in proportion to the way that Christmas is going to be, with the family at the center, the children being recipients, and then not excluded, but certainly minimized, is the creche. Okay, next picture is the following year. This was not originally in color, but some people have taken these sorts of pictures and made them color, and I chose this just so that you could see the parts of it better. This is Santa Claus and his works, and here's this little elf, so lively and quick. Here he is up here on the left-hand side. He's spying to see who's, you know, which children are good and which are bad. Here he's on a ladder and he's decorating. I can't remember what these are. What's that? I can't see from this angle. It's Santa Claus. Okay. There's Santa Claus with his feet at the fire. Here he is checking the list. I simply can't make that out from here. But this is all of what Santa Claus does. So now I've got a picture of it, and which I find really interesting, because we haven't had a picture of, we've had words, but here are the pictures. And these background things seem to be all from his workshop, things that he's doing in his workshop. There are toys and dolls, that sort of thing. So here's a man who's single-handedly, just out of his own sort of I'm crazy for Christmas sort of spirit, just starts generating this. And over the course of a half century, Harper's itself publishes over 30 of these wood engravings, and that they are so widely distributed that I would argue that Americans really learned Christmas from reading, and then brought their own individual customs and foods from various places and celebrate that. But these sorts of imageries and these sorts of rituals are created by the media, are press creations. So then I think that Thomas Nasterly does it all here. And this is in 1881, and this is basically our official portrait of Santa Claus. Here he is. He may be short, but he doesn't look like it anymore. To me, what he looks like is he looks like one of the robber barons or the captains of industry. He looks like Jay Gould or J.P. Morgan, Andrew Carnegie, all those men who show how well they, you know, because being large was a sign that you had enough money to live well. Here he's got a long stem pipe. He looks, Nasta's got a mustache just like that. How about that for a conceit? So Thomas Nast has sort of drawn himself in here. And then we've got all of these toys. This says US on it, on this, whatever this band is. And so these are all these toys, and then time hanging from his waist. So here's the Santa Claus that starts to be sort of, it becomes the father anchor of this new holiday. All right, we need a few more things to get this thing going. This is from 1843. This is an English card. There were only about 1,000 printed. It's called the Horsley card. People used to give trading, a calling card or a trade card. You'd put your name on it and leave it in a silver dish if you called on somebody. And then people started putting small advertisements for their businesses. And in this case, this was just a little bit smaller than 3x5, and says a Merry Christmas, a Happy New Year to you. And people were really taken by this because they hadn't thought about actually sending something through the mails that wasn't just an advertisement. This also coincides with the penny post big change. Instead of postage costing, taking so much money to send things, all of a sudden the price of sending went down to, if you could buy a penny stamp, you could send cards everywhere. So there are a number of changes that made this possible. Apparently there's a lot of controversy about this because there are children drinking And I hadn't noticed that, but somebody pointed out, here's this girl with her glass of Pinot Noir saying, this is really great holiday, Mom. The real person, though, is another German immigrant. This one is Louis Prang. I don't know if you remember this, but do you remember back when you had school supplies and you always, do I probably speaking for myself, wanted one of those watercolor, you know, those little pans of, with, yes, Prang paints. That's the man. So Louis Prang came from Germany and needed something to do, and so he started making maps of the Civil War, and then the Civil War ended, so he still doesn't have something to do. And so he invented a four-part printing process, color chromolithography, big innovation, and starts to print Christmas cards in about 1875. These are like the finest, best Christmas cards people have ever seen. This is particularly Victorian. He starts off, no, don't look. He starts off early on with birds and things like violets and things like that. And later on, they'll start to get the idea that Christmas is about snow and pine cones and so on. But in this case, you know, early on, the pictures were a lot of, you know, animals and birds and flowers. And then this crazy stuff, excuse me, that's not polite. This decoration here is, I guess that's the idea of Victorian decoration. If you can get an extra layer on something, the Victorians are really, really happy. And so these came sort of as furry cards. Prang's idea was is you take these cards and they would be so fine that in a democratic nation, they weren't expensive either, that you would send these and then people would put these on their walls and they would have art. And he'd hold contests for artists to illustrate these. He had sort of big studios of women, because he thought women actually did this better, to hand color the cards as well. And so this was a job that women, I guess, you know, it's a strike for women's equality that they could, he would hire almost exclusively women to do this. So now starts a way to start exchanging all these greetings, and you think about all the way, apparently through most of American history, a fourth of all Americans have their belongings in a suitcase and are moving. It's now, this generation is now settling down, believe it or not. But if you think about all those immigrants and all those people moving to various towns, moving from the farm to the city, from the city out west, that this is a way to communicate is by sending cards. And Prang was right in the center of it. We also need more shopping. And so department stores have ample space that they start stocking just precisely for holidays. There's very little distinction at first between, they advertise for holiday goods, and I think this sign up here says holiday goods of every description. It doesn't say Christmas. You just buy them for the holiday because people also primarily gave gifts at New Year's. So you can see that Christmas almost becomes a magnet and it's going to start drawing things toward it. Just when you go into a department store, you might find this interesting. See this glass? You can't see it's glass because you can see through it. But this was something that was a big innovation, was plate glass. And then with electricity and then with mirrors, the department stores were really apparently very, very fabulous wonderlands themselves. You could look at things, and women were invited to go in and actually, I think the word they even used was loiter, that you didn't have to buy, you could just kind of look around and look. But this glass, you see, and this is really not emphasized in the picture, here's this little girl in her furs and her stylish fry boots, whatever they are, and here are all the toys, and then here are these little street urchins, and they're wanting, but they're barred off from the glass. So that makes us feel a little bit sad about Christmas too. So we've got shopping, we've got gifts, and this, I think, brings it all together. Here's another one of those. That's the other creepy Santa. There he is, just like, I don't know, I think his name is Tom Santa. There are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 children in the bed. There's some sort of tower of cards here. This Christmas tree is gotten much bigger than the 4 foot tall. And it's got all these garlands and, do you see how, even see how much Christmas trees have changed? That how orderly our Christmas trees are? I mean, there's like you put a, you know, you everything's lined up and even on our Christmas trees. The lights evenly distributed and everything. This, I'd say, is not orderly. And then there are just toys down here, all sorts of things. And you get the idea clearly here that this is America in that sense of there's so much, at least for children of a certain social class, and that it's all brought together here in this one holiday. And then he calls it 'Twas the Night Before Christmas. So now we're still, we're going back to the beginning and looking to see what Clement Clark Moore informs cleared, you know, 75 years into the future. All right, so let's make another leap. And this is just into the 20th century. I find this, and if this depresses you, don't look, but I think Santa starts to lose his power. I think that he kind of peaked out there somewhere in the late 19th century, and I'd actually run into, somebody had done a data search, where you can now do searches to see how many times a word is used in like a whole run of magazines, or multiple runs of magazines, and it showed that in the late 19th century, people said Santa Claus like this much more than St. Nicholas. And so the use of the word Santa Claus had even gone up in the late 19th century. And we were talking about this and thought maybe part of this that we give up the word St. Nicholas because there are so many new immigrants that are coming in that are Catholic and it sounds a little bit too popish again. And so that Santa Claus sounds a little bit better. But in any case, by the 20th century, we start, I think, start to see some decline in Santa's powers. These are the famous, they're gorgeous drawings by Norman Rockwell. This one from 1920, it's one of the first of the Saturday Evening Post covers, but look at the halo. And he's got this liturgical looking, you know, thing that looks for anything like it looks biblical to me anyway. And so the red vest, way from, you know, the old bishop times, but here's someone who's clearly, you know, I happen to know there's a depression during the time, so maybe he's not thinking about that, but he's got this sort of how am I ever going to get this thing solved kind of look about him. He's starting to worry. I think he's a modern Santa. He's concerned. He's got all these shining faces, and he's trying to sort things out in these ledger books. Fast forward a little bit. This is Norman Rockwell. And this is when I'm seeing that Santa starts to lose some of his power. We see increasingly images of children discovering the truth. There's one little boy who's opening the bottom drawer of the dresser and he sees a beard, you know, it's his dad's dresser and he sees, you know, he's seen the Santa costume that his dad's got in the dresser drawer and the kid's just looking there like, oh no. And in this one, while he's looking around the corner, this is Santa sitting on the train after clearly a hard day and, you know, he's just a plain old tired worker man. So it's funny and it's, you know, it's warm-hearted the way Norman Rockwell is, but it also shows us that something has kind of slipped a little bit. I think also we start to see, and part of this may be that, is that Santa becomes a pitch man. here he is, on the famous Santa Claus that is the update of the last one, but still got the red robes. He's still got, I'm sorry, when I start looking at pictures with people, I start seeing different things. So I just realized his beard looks just as furry as this, and I'm wondering then what this is. Ermine? Let's say ermine, but that's not ermine, okay? He's got the big belt. I mean, he looks for all alike like Santa Claus, except he's holding this like the Statue of Liberty, which is how we were supposed to regard Coke anyway. But Santa Claus would chill for lots of things. I mean, here's camels and Prince Albert. So we start to see him in lots of places, which kind of breaks down some of his authority about living in the North Pole and being secret and not, you know, we don't know where he is at any time. Well, we know where he is. He's on Madison Avenue. This next one, though, about the Santa pitch is that there seems to be this, talk about Americans being creative in the middle of the Depression. No, it's late Depression, 1937. Montgomery Ward is thinking, how can we get more people into the store? They were worried about it then, even. And how can we get more people in? And so one of the ad designers came up with this story about another reindeer. So here's America's already got eight reindeer. Other nations only have one reindeer, and some even have just a horse. And we've got now nine. So, and I put those down so you wouldn't be, I put the names down so that you wouldn't be puzzling for the rest of the evening about that. But here's a reindeer that is special and now can be the leader of all these other reindeer and this kind of ads. And so there's this really interesting way in which commercial interests are helping add to that Christmas that we celebrate. So my last point about Santa's power receding is that this is from Miracle on 34th Street. And Santa Claus, as you know, arrives in Miracle on 34th Street. When you first see him, he is he drunk? I think that he is. And he keeps saying things like, I'm Santa Claus, and no one believes him. And they actually recommend him for psychiatric help. But he keeps insisting, I'm Santa Claus. But look at, I mean, he goes and plays Santa Claus, but no one believes he's really Santa Claus. This is the way he looks in real life. He's escaped from the old folks' home, which is called Maplewood. And in there, well then, he's just a plain old guy. And the miracle on this that happens is actually carried out by the little girl. It's the little girl who's encouraged by the imagination that she gets her mother and, I forgot what his name is, Fred. I don't think I wrote it down. Somebody know? Who does Fred the boyfriend? Okay, she gets them together. The little girl gets the couple together. So she's got a real father. She's got a real home, a real family. And so now we've recreated again for Christmas the real family, but it's the child who does this, the girl child who does this, not Santa Claus. So by the 1950s then, we're ready to settle into an all-out, full-fledged Christmas that's the best Christmases that we ever remembered, ever. So, I found these two pictures and I was so struck by how similar they are. One's an advertisement, and here is a picture that I know is in one of your albums, and it may be in one of mine someplace. The big tree with the tinsel on it, and the family. She's got the children's pictures down at the floor here, but we'll just move on. And this one then pulls the whole thing together. So we've got everything here. We've got Dad is in charge. He's the Santa Claus. Now we know. Mom is doting on him. There's a little bit of sarcasm in my voice, but I don't. Yeah, this is kind of the way it is in the 1950s. They've got a new television. Everything is just perfect in that sort of memory, and that's sort of a snapshot of how all of this gets realized. So if you've got Clement Clark Moore gives us the imagination, Thomas Nast gives us the pictures to populate out the imagination, and then advertisement sets up what the tableau should look like for the families to reenact. Or do the families do that and then the advertisements copy it? In any case, they're fairly in sync, and then to make it this really iconic sort of image with new technology, with everybody in their proper relationship. This is in part a statement about the Cold War as well, because one of the things that Christmas does is create safety. If we look back to Clement Clark Moore, and he's concerned about those ruffians, those hooligans, breaking into his house and destroying his property, he's looking for safety, and we find the safety in the home. All of the changes that go on in the 19th century, there's such rapid change, numbers of population, technology, geographic expansion, that the home becomes this really safe place where you go and things are manageable, they're comfortable, they're loving, they're generous, and they're very safe. And we get to the Cold War and we have those same issues being played out, those same themes, just a different context. And then finally, just my point about that Grinch. First off, I guess what my point being that Santa Claus starts losing his power and it continues to erode, and in particular, I'm focused on Cindy Lou Who, that Cindy Lou Who is the linchpin for this whole thing. It's the little girl who's going to hold the Christmas together. Santa Claus is Santa Claus is a Grinch. And that dog Max, remember, I didn't have a picture of Max. Max is the dog that he ties the antlers on, and Max is so unhappy having to pretend like he's a reindeer. So this Christmas then has made this huge evolution. It's got these same themes, but each of the parts of the themes starts to rearrange. And I think that I would say that that's really what keeps this Christmas going and why it's so important. There's something like $450 billion spent on Christmas each year. It's a phenomenal amount. And for businesses, that's in many businesses, that if they don't make it at Christmas, that Christmas is supposed to take them all the way through the rest of the year. But I think that those businesses also, because of the economic focus of the holiday, that's what keeps it for us also, that if we didn't have this commercial aspect, if we didn't have all of these other aspects, keeps Christmas in the public sphere. What I'd been talking about in the late 19th century is private. It should go into your home and you close the doors. During the 20th century, it becomes increasingly public. And as it becomes public, the thing about Christmas that we all know is it becomes contested. Is this my space for Christmas or your space for some other holiday? It becomes this way in which we negotiate who we are next to each other. And Christmas seems to be one of those particular places that it's got so much emotional hit for everybody, regardless whether you celebrate or not, that when we see Dr. Seuss having the audacity to kind of flip Christmas, we start to look at Christmas in another way. We don't think about Christmas negatively, but we start to see it in a slightly different light. So with that, I think that Christmas is what we have within the culture, and it changes within the culture. And it is all of those things that are really charming and sometimes really troubling. It's hectic, it's contentious, it's familial, it's spiritual, it's generous, it's wasteful, and there are so many other adjectives, but the fact that it keeps us sort of, you know, it keeps pressing buttons on us, and that's why we keep celebrating it and keep changing it. I'm finished. Thank you.